This lecture is part of an online course on commutative or homological algebra, and we will be talking about the groups tor I R of A B, where R is a ring and A and B are R modules. If R happens to be non-commutative, then A should be a right R module and B should be a left R module, but we usually do the commutative case, so we won't worry about that too much. So in the first couple of lectures, we calculated this group when R was the ring of integers. And in the case of integers, these are non-zero only for I equals zero or one, and you generally miss out the subscript I. So first we give the definition. And this is similar to the definition for the integers, only more so. So for the integers, we took a resolution of A by r to the n naught and r to the n one. Now, over the integers, if we take a free module, then any submodule of a free module is also free. So if we want, we can stop the resolution here. For more general rings, we have to keep going if we want the sequence to be exact and so on. So that we have a possibly infinite sequence here where this is exact. So the image of each map is the kernel of the next map. So that's step one. Step two is we tensor this with B. So we get B to the N3 goes to B to the N2, goes to B to the N1, goes to B to the N0. And we drop out the A. And in fact, we put a zero there. That's not a misprint. I really am missing out the A. And the third step is we take the homology groups of this sequence. So if we call this map D, we're taking the homology of the operator D, which means we're looking at the groups where we take the kernel of B to the Ni to B to the Ni minus 1 and quotienting it out by the image of B to the Ni plus 1 goes to B to the Ni. So this is the ith homology group of this, and by definition, it's equal to tor I R of A and B. So just as for the integers, we have several questions. First of all, is it well defined? In other words, is it independent of the choice of resolution? Secondly, we want to show that it's a functor in A and B. Thirdly, we want to show it's symmetric. In other words, tor IAB equals tor IBA. I'm missing out the superscript R out of laziness. The fourth condition, a very persistent ant. So the fourth condition is the long exact sequence. So if we've got a short exact sequence of modules, naught goes to A, goes to B, goes to C, goes to zero, the ant is back again, either unusually stupid ant or unusually interested in homological algebra. Anyway, so from this we get the exact sequence of modules and as for the integers, it's not necessarily exact on the left, but we can fix this with the first tor group. And then we get a tor B with M and a tor 1A with M. But then this map here need not be exact, and we can fix that by putting a tor 2CM. And we just sort of keep going infinitely long. I'm not going to prove any of these this lecture, although I'll probably do so next lecture. What I'm going to do instead is give some examples of Tor. So we will first give some examples of Tor groups turning up in other areas of mathematics, and then give some examples of calculations. So example one, they appear in Sayre's definition of intersection multiplicities. So if you've got two subvarieties of an algebraic variety, they might intersect. For instance, you might have a curve here and a curve here intersecting in this point. And you can see in some sense, you should really count this as having intersection multiplicity two, that are sort of two points of intersection in the same place. And it was quite a problem for a long time to define an analogous intersection multiplicity in higher dimensions. And Sayre came up with this rather nice definition. It's just sum over I of minus one to the I of Tor I R of R over I R over J. Except I guess we should really take the length of this. So here R is a local ring, and I and J are ideals corresponding. So R would be the local ring of this point here, and I and J would be ideals corresponding to subvarieties meeting at that point. So a second example would be homology of a group. So if G is a group, then Eilenberg and MacLane defined its homology groups, Hig, with coefficients in a representation M of G, and their original definition was rather somewhat roundabout, but it turned out to be the same as Tor over I of Z and M, where the ring here is the group ring. So homology of groups is a special case of the Tor functor. A similar example is homology of Lie algebras. So again, we can define the homology group of a Lie algebra A with coefficients and some module. And this turns out to be Tor over I of UG Tor I of UG, so not A, with R of M, where R is the reals. So here UG is the universal enveloping algebra. Of the Lie algebra A. So we can turn the homology of Lie algebras into a problem about Tor for modules over a certain ring. Example four is Hochschild homology of an algebra. So the Hochschild cohomology of an algebra A with coefficients in the bimodule just turns out to be Tor over I of A tensored with the opposite algebra of A with coefficients in the module M. So these three examples, homology of groups, homology of Lie algebras, and Hochschild homology, were originally defined independently in different rather ad hoc ways. And it was afterwards noticed that they were all special cases of the Tor of modules over a suitable algebra. So Tor, the Tor functor unifies three apparently different theories. So now we'll come on to some calculation of examples of Tor groups. If you look at the definition of Tor, it looks kind of really complicated and roundabout and difficult to use. But in fact, in practice, it's usually rather easy to calculate Tor groups. So the first example, we're going to take R to be the polynomial algebra over a field in one variable, only to make it easier, we're just going to quotient out by x squared. So R is a two-dimensional vector space, which has a base 1 and x. And we're going to take the module M to be K, which we think of as an R module because it's R modulo the ideal x. And what we're going to do is we're going to compute tor I over R of K with itself. So how do we do this? Well, we look at this module here and we have to take a resolution of it. So let's take a resolution of K, and then we must map R to K, and we can take the element 1 to 1, rather obviously, and that maps onto the kernel of this is obviously just the one-dimensional vector space spanned by x. So we can make this exact by mapping 1 to the element x. Now, the kernel of this map is, again, the element x, which maps to x squared, which is 0. So we can make the sequence exact by mapping 1 to x. And we're obviously in a sort of loop here. We just keep going, just always mapping 1 to x. So we get a resolution of k by three R modules, all of which happen to be one dimensional. So that's the first step. We take a resolution of k. The second step is we tensor with this module here that we're calculating tor of. Well, if we tensor R with K, we just get K. So we get our sequence looks like this. And now we have to figure out what the maps are. Well, this maps 1 to X, which is 0 in K. So all these maps are just 0. And thirdly, we take the homology of this complex. Well, since all the maps are 0, the homology is obvious. It's just K. So this is tor 0 K with K. This is tor 1 K and K. This is tor 2, and this is tor 3, and so on. So we see that tor I of K and K is equal to K for all I greater than or equal to 0. In particular, this shows, for example, that there's no finite resolution of K by three modules, because if we had a finite resolution, then all these groups would be 0 once we got past the length of that resolution. Of course, it's very easy to show there's no finite resolution without using tor in this particularly simple example. So the next example, let's look at the ring R, which is now going to be polynomials in two variables. And I'm going to take the module K00 to be R over xy. I have to be a little bit careful here because K can be an R module in many different ways. We could have KAB to be R modulo x minus A, y minus B. So we can make K into a module in for each point of the two-dimensional affine space over R. Anyway, let's start with this K first. Now we first have to find a resolution of K00. And the easiest way to do this is to draw a picture. So let's draw a picture of R. Right then, 1x, x squared, x cubed, and so on. And then we have y, y squared, y cubed, xy, x squared, y, xy squared, and so on. And now, we can map R onto K, and the kernel will be all this stuff here. And the kernel is generated by X and Y. So we can find two free R modules, a green one, which is one dimensional, and another one dimensional one spanned by X. And then these two modules mapping onto this orange module will have a common kernel, which is this module here. So the picture of the resolution looks like this. And now let me write it out in more algebraic terms. We've got this orange module mapping onto K. And then we've got this green free module R plus R, where this element here, 1, 0, maps to, say, x, and 0, 1 maps to, say, y. And then we've got this pink R module, where we're mapping the element 1 to, say, y minus x. And finally, it's easy to see that this sequence is exact. So here we've got a resolution of K of length 3. And now we can tensor this with K0, 0. So we get naught goes to K, goes to K squared, goes to K, goes to naught. And as usual, we sort of cross off this term here. And we have to figure out what these maps are here. Well, since X and Y are 0 in K, these maps are all 0. So if we take the homology, we just get K, K squared, K. So this is tor 0, this is tor 1, and this is tor 2. And so the fact that tor 2 is non-zero shows that we couldn't have found a resolution of length less than this. And the other thing we can do is compute tor of K00 with one of these other modules here. So let's try that. So we've got this resolution of K, which takes R goes to R squared, goes to R, goes to K, goes to 0. So you remember this took 1 to y minus x, and it took 1, 0 to x, and 0, 1 to y. And we're now going to tensor this with, say, let's just do k 0, 1, just to be explicit. And then when we tensor it with k, we get k goes to k squared, goes to k. However, these maps here are no longer 0 because this is taking 1 to 1, 0, and this is taking 1, 0 to 0, and 0, 1 to 1. So in fact, we see that this sequence is exact. So if we take homology, we get 0, 0, 0. And here we see that the tor I of K0, 0 with K0, 1 is equal to naught for all values I. And in fact, you can see that if we take two of these modules corresponding to points in the plane, then these tor I's will have dimension 1, 2, 1 if these are the same points, and will all be 0 if the points are different. As an exercise, you can do the same thing for a polynomial algebra in three variables, not two variables. And then you should find there's a tor 3 that is non-zero. So for the last example, I'm going to calculate the homology of a cyclic group of order n with coefficients in, say, Z. So this is going to be group homology. And we remember that this is defined to be tor I of the group ring of Z over NZ of Z over NZ and Z. So we've got to calculate this. Well, first thing is to figure out what the group ring is. Well, let's write a cyclic group of order n multiplicatively. So let's take the group ring to have a basis of elements 1, g, g squared up to g to the n minus 1 with g to the n equals 1. So that gives us the group ring. Now we have to find a resolution of z over this group ring. So we have to find something mapping onto Z. Let's take the group ring G, and we can map this onto Z just by mapping the element 1 to 1. And the element G to the I will then also map to 1 because, in case I didn't say so, I'm taking the group G to be acting trivially on Z. Now we need to figure out what the kernel of this is. Well, the kernel is generated by 1 minus G. That's generated as a module over the group G, because 1 minus G obviously maps to 1 and it's, sorry, to 0. And it's easy to check that conversely, anything mapping to 0 must be generated by this. So we can make this sequence exact by mapping something onto 1 minus G. So let's just take the element 1 of this and map it to 1 minus G. Now, what's the kernel of this? Well, the kernel, it's not difficult to see, is generated by 1 plus g squared plus g to the n minus 1. So we can make this exact by taking another copy of zg here and mapping 1 to 1 plus g to the n minus 1. And what's the kernel of this? Well, the kernel is now generated by 1 minus g, as you can easily check. So let's continue. We now map 1 to 1 minus g. And that, now you see we're going around in circles, because here we've got 1 mapping to 1 minus g, and here we've gone 1 to 1 mapping g to 1 minus g. So the sequence just extends indefinitely to the left with period 2. Now, the next step is to tensor this sequence with Z. So we get Z goes to Z, goes to Z, goes to Z, etc., goes to 0. Now we've got to work out what these maps are. Well, this map here, you remember it takes 1 to 1 minus G, which is actually equal to 0 in G. So this map is 0. This map, on the other hand, takes 1 to 1 plus g plus g to the n minus 1. And as g is equal to 1, this map here is a multiplication by n. Similarly, this map takes 1 to 1 minus g, so it's just the 0 map. So our map is, this is 0, this is multiplication by n, this is 0, and so on. And since it's periodic, this is also multiplication by n. Now we take the homology groups. Well, that's easy to work out. So the homology here is just Z. And the homology here is Z modulo NZ, because the kernel is the whole of Z and the image of the multiples of N. Here, on the other hand, the homology is 0 because the kernel of this is 0. And here the homology is Z over NZ, and so on. So this is the zeroth homology of Z over NZ with coefficients in Z. This one here is the first homology of Z over NZ with coefficients in Z. This is the second homology group. This is the third homology group, and so on. So the homology of a cyclic group, at least with coefficients in Z, is periodic apart from the first term, which is a little bit odd. In fact, it's pretty obvious the homology with coefficients in any module will have period 2 apart from the first term, because the resolution of Z was periodic. Okay, that's enough examples for the moment. So next lecture will probably be on checking the basic properties of Tor over a ring, such as the long exact sequence and the symmetry and so on.